So today, we're going to talk about how you can get a can make progress and get a result out of your walk with Christ. So for me, I've been on a muscle gaining diet now for the better part of a month. And it's great, I'm going great for me. But there are periods during that process where I don't want to do it, where I don't want to go and do it. But if I don't, how am I going to get a healthier body and reach my goal? How am I going to see an end result if I don't step out and do it? As Jay mentioned earlier, the passage that I'm going to be preaching from is Acts 4 verses 5-22. So if you have your Bibles, you can flip over to that. I'm going to be paraphrasing it for the most part. So the high priests and the religious rulers of the day called a meeting. They called for a meeting, and the reason why they do this is because earlier on in Acts chapter 3, they saw Peter and John healing a paralyzed man who had been paralyzed from birth. And so they called Peter and John in, and they asked them a question. Simply, why are you doing this? What name gives you the right to do this? Why are you doing this? And they asked them that question. Peter essentially puts them on blast for the crucifixion of our Lord. He puts them on blast for what happened to Jesus less than 3 weeks earlier. And in fact, in doing so, he actually gives us a few things that can happen to us when we step out in faith. I'm just going to name two of them now. So, when we step out in faith and when we talk to people about Christ, it proves that, for one thing, Jesus is the only name that can save and that can give salvation. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And, again, that name of Jesus, the Pharisees and the leaders were trying so hard to stamp that name out because they thought it was done. They thought it was over and done with. And they were trying to stop it from spreading. The second thing that Peter proves is that speaking of in the name of Jesus gives you the power of God. It even mentions at the beginning when Peter is giving his answer, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, which in itself is the power of God manifest. So Peter gives his answer, puts him on blast with the crucifixion, and basically says that it was foretold that it was going to happen, and that he's risen from the dead. The Pharisees, in response, they do something kind of funny. They send them out, and they have a discussion about what to do, and they don't really know what to do about this. Because essentially, they're between a rock and a hard place. No matter what they do, they're going to lose. So, in the end, they summon Peter and John back into them, and they warn them not to speak in Jesus' name. But, here's what Peter and John do. Peter and John, upon coming back in for essentially another lecture, basically say that they can't stop talking about what they've seen and heard, because Jesus quite literally changed their lives for the better. Turn them upside down, if you will. He literally changed them all from the inside out, all 11 of them. So, in trying to quench those flames, the flames of the gospel message, in trying to stop it from spreading, it had the opposite effect. It made it spread more like a wildfire. So, if you will, the Pharisees essentially flunked that test. And in the end, they end up letting them go because they realize there's nothing they can do to stop it. Because the people were praising God and they were giving glory for what had happened to the man. And in the process, the church expanded. And it expanded afterwards, we can agree.
Yes.
It expanded after that, but it wasn't easy, and it didn't happen overnight. In fact, later on in the book of Acts, it talks about how not only were the disciples thrown into prison for what they were saying, but some of them were even whipped and beaten for it. Now, that was back in the first century AD. And fortunately today, we live in a country where we can practice our faith freely, thanks to the First Amendment. And I thank God that we did for that. But the command is still the same. Nobody ever said that sharing the gospel with anybody was going to be an easy task. It gets easier over time, but that first step is always the hardest. In fact, Christ himself stated in John 15:20 that when we stand up for him, there is going to be opposition. There's going to be opposition towards the message, and we're going to be persecuted or put down. Again, the penalty isn't going to be as severe as it was back in Acts in the first century. But there is going to be something to train. There's going to be a price to pay for it. Might be a coworker, a friend, time, maybe even your job. You're standing up for Christ. There's going to be something that you have to give up. That we're all going to have to give up. The question is, are you willing to pay it? If you look at Acts, Peter and John were. The question is, are you? The result of the Christian life, the ultimate end goal that you're striving for, and that you're making step-by-step progress towards, is to ultimately be transformed into the image of Christ himself. I mean, it's literally in the definition of what being a Christian is, being like Christ. In fact, Christ himself even states that there will be treasures waiting for us in heaven as a result of sharing his word with people and sharing the gospel with them. Just a random question. What did Jesus do for you? Anyone?
Died on the cross.
What was that?
He died on the cross.
Yeah.
Saved me from my sins.
Yes. So, when we accept Christ, the depression, the anxieties, the fear, everything that was a part of what our old self was, those are all washed away. It's all washed away. And he not only gives us hearts of flesh, but he also gives us unbelievable and unspeakable joy. He literally changes us, like he did with Peter and John, from the inside out. On top of that, we've been given salvation, the literal gift of God through Christ himself, and not to mention a ticket to heaven and paradise. Wouldn't you want to see people and tell people how they can get that gift? Wouldn't you want to tell them how they can be in heaven and how they can accept Jesus? How they can be safe from eternal damnation? I conclude with an expanded version of the question that I started out with. How can we, as the church, as the body of Christ itself, see the church expand if we don't get out here and actually tell people about what spawned the church in the first place? The message of the gospel and of Christ. If we do that, we can be exactly like the early church was. And just as they conquered all of Asia Minor within 2 years, all of the known world at that time, we, by extension, can win this country back for Christ.
Amen.
Thank you so much for listening.
Amen.